Hello dear learners, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Devraj Goyal from CIET NCERT New Delhi, India. Today we will focus on teacher education on human rights. It is under the course Perspectives, Issues and Research in Teacher Education. Let us delineate the objectives. After going through this module, the learners will be able to define the human rights, tell the genesis of human rights declaration, list various human rights, discriminate constitutional, legal, fundamental human rights, and educate on human rights. Each entity has its own worth. The nature has provided every entity with identity. But when we look around, some shaking news attacks us. Handful of us are in power at the cost of masses. The world has witnessed World War I and II, whereas World War III is ringing. The horror felt by people globe over after World War II caused a significant change in the attitude towards human rights. In 1945-51, countries joined together to form the United Nations and pledge to protect human rights. On 10th December 1948, United Nations adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The declaration symbolized the beginning of the international human rights movement. But it is a tragic truth that even after about 71 years of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, establishment of human rights culture seems to be a distant dream. The world is more insecure place today than it was in the past. The world has witnessed increased number of incidents due to fundamentalism and terrorism. For the protection of human rights, it is very essential that people are fully conscious of their rights. Students need to be sensitized as to how the observance of human rights in their day-to-day life enhances quality of life in the society. The process of educating people should begin from the early school itself. The concept of human rights should develop from one level of education to another. Brief history of human rights. Human rights are as old as the history of human civilization. Some of the important events which have affected human rights movement were the Cyrus Cylinder, 539 BC. In 539 BC, the armies of Cyrus the Great conquered the city of Babylon. But these were progressive actions that marked a major advance for man. The slaves were liberated, and it was declared that all people had the right to choose their own religion and establish racial equality. The spread of human rights from Babylon, the idea of human rights spread quickly to India, Greece, and eventually Rome. There, the concept of natural law arose in observation of the fact that people tended to follow certain unwritten laws in the course of life, and Roman law was based on rational ideas derived from the nature of things. Magna Carta 1215 is considered as the foundation of their liberty by Englishmen. It guaranteed the citizens the freedom from arbitrary imprisonment and or from dispossession of property. In 1215, after King John of England violated a number of ancient laws and customs by which England had been governed, his subject forced him to sign the Magna Carta, which enumerates what later came to be thought of as human rights. Among them was the right of the church to be free from governmental interference, the rights of all free citizens to own and inherit property and to be protected from excessive taxes. It established the right of widows who own property to choose not to remarry and established principles of due process and equality before the law. The Magna Carta was a crucial turning point in the struggle to establish freedom. Then Petition of Right, 1628. The next recorded milestone in the development of human rights was the Petition of Right, produced in 1628 by the English Parliament and sent to Charles I as a statement of civil liberties. The Petition of Right, initiated by Sir Edward Coke, was based upon earlier statutes and charters and asserted four principles. 1. No taxes may be levied without consent of Parliament. 2. No subject may be imprisoned without cause shown. No soldiers may be quartered upon the citizenry. And 4. Martial law may not be used in time of peace. The Bill of Rights, 1689 in England, conferred some important rights of the British Parliament. It also declared many actions of King James II as illegal. The American Declaration of Independence, July 4, 1776, declared, "We hold these rights to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." The French Revolution, 1789, proclaimed the slogans of liberty, equality, and fraternity. The League of Nations, set up in 1920, after the First World War, was entrusted with the protection of rights of minorities, but it failed in its basic aim of preventing war, Second World War. The Second World War, 1939-45, proved to be the most destructive war in history. The desire of the nations to make the world free from future wars and ushering in an era of international peace led to the establishment of the UNO, that is United Nations Organization, in 1945. Its charter contained a number of articles relating to human rights. UN Commission on Human Rights in 1946, the UN established the Commission on Human Rights, the principal policy-making body for human rights within the UN system. Basically, we could not have peace or an atmosphere in which peace could grow unless we recognize the rights of individual human beings, their importance, their dignity, and agreed. That was the basic thing that had to be accepted throughout the world. Eleanor Roosevelt, USA. Under the chairmanship of Eleanor Roosevelt, human rights activist and widow of former US President Franklin Roosevelt, the commission took up the job of defining basic rights and freedoms. Key contributors included René Cassin, France, Charles Malik, Lebanon, Peng Chung-Chang, China, Heman Santa Cruz, Chile, Alexander Bogomolov and Alexei Pavlov, Soviet Union, Lord Duquesne and Geoffrey Wilson, United Kingdom, William Hosson, Australia, and John Humphrey, Canada. Originally composed of 18 member states, the Human Rights Commission now has 53 members who meet annually in Geneva to review human rights issues, develop and codify new international norms, and make recommendations to governments. Non-governmental organizations also play an active role. The General Assembly of the UN passed the Universal Declaration of Human Rights on December 10, 1948. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The first two articles are fundamental principles underlying all human rights. Article 3 to 21 comprise civil and political rights. Article 22 to 27 refer to economic, social, and cultural rights. The last three articles provide a framework of solidarity, safeguarding the universal enjoyment of all human rights. Article 1, right to freedom and equality in dignity and rights. Article 2, freedom from discrimination. Right to life, liberty, and security of person. Article 4, right to freedom from slavery and servitude. Article 5, right to freedom from torture or degrading treatment. Article 6, right to recognition as a person before the law. Article 7, right to equal consideration before the law. Article 8, right to remedy through a competent tribunal. Article 9, right to freedom from arbitrary arrest or exile. Article 10, right to a fair trial or public hearing. 11, right to be considered innocent until proven guilty. 12, freedom from interference with privacy, including home, family, and correspondence. Article 13, right to freedom of movement and residence in one's own country and to leave and return at will. Article 14, right to asylum. 15, right to a nationality and freedom to change it. Article 16, right to marriage and protection of family. 17, right to own property. 18, freedom of belief and religion. 19, freedom of opinion and information. 20, right to peaceful assembly and association. 21, right to participate in government and in free elections and to equal access to public service. Right to social security. 23, right to work and fair pay for work. Article 24, right to rest and leisure. 25, right to adequate standard of living for healthy and well-being. 26, right to education. 27, right to participate in the cultural life of the community. 28, right to social order, assuring human rights. Article 29, responsibility to community, essential to free and full development of the individual. Article 30, right for protection of these rights from state or other interference, incorporates the fundamental values as contained in the UN Declaration of Human Rights. There are several articles in Part 3 of the Constitution entitled Fundamental Rights, which are quite parallel to the Declaration. Likewise, Part 4, Directive Principles of State Policy, contains several provisions similar to human rights. Article 14 of the Constitution provides, the state shall not deny to any person equality before law. This provision reflects the spirit of Article 2 of the UN Declaration of Human Rights. Article 19 of our Constitution gives every Indian the right to move freely, settle and reside in any part of India. This is commensurate with the Article 13 of the Declaration, which provides for freedom of movement and residence. Other provisions in our Constitution which are parallel to the Declaration of Human Rights include right of freedom of worship and propagation of religion, Article 25, right of conservation of one's language and culture, Article 29, right to equal pay for equal work for both men and women, Article 39, and right to have free and compulsory education up to the age of 14, Article 21A. Table 1.1, Fundamental Rights in the Indian Constitution, which are by and large parallel to UN Declaration of Human Rights. Let us take up one by one. UN Declaration of Human Rights and then Indian Constitution and Fundamental Rights. Article 1, Right to Freedom, is corresponding to Article 19. Article 2, Freedom from Discrimination, Article 15. Article 3, Right to Life, Liberty and Security of Persons, Article 21. Article 4, no one shall be held in slavery or servitude. It is Article 23. Article 5, freedom from torture or degrading, corresponding to Article 23. Article 6, 7, equality before law, Article 14. Article 8, right to remedy through a competent tribunal, corresponding to Article 32. Article 9, freedom from arbitrary arrest, Article 22. Article 13, right to freedom of movement and residence, Article 19D and E. Article 18, freedom of belief and religion, Article 25. Article 19, freedom of opinion and information, Article 19A. Article 20, Right to Peaceful Assembly and Association, Article 19B. Article 21, Right to Equal Access to Public Service, Article 16A. Article 26, Right to Education, Article 21A. Article 30, Freedom from State or Other Interference in Any of the Above Rights, Article 32. Now, UN Convention on the Rights of Children. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, CRC, is the first legally binding international instrument to incorporate the full range of human rights, civil, cultural, economic, political, and social rights. On November 20th, 1989, world leaders decided that children needed a special convention just for them because people under 18 years old often need special care and protection that adults do not. The leaders, who also wanted to make sure that the world recognized that children have human rights too, all UN members except the United States and Somalia have ratified Convention on the Rights of Children, that is CRC. US Senator Barbara Boxer, California, is urging United States ratification. 1. Children have the right to live. Government should ensure that children survive and develop healthily. Number 2. All children have the right to a legally registered name, officially recognized by the government. Children have the right to a nationality, to belong to a country. Children also have the right to know and, as far as possible, to be cared for by their parents. 3. Children have the right to an identity, an official record of who they are. Governments should respect children's right to a name, a nationality, and family ties. 4. Children have the right to live with their parents unless it is bad for them. Children whose parents do not live together have the right to stay in contact with both parents unless this might hurt the child. Families whose members live in different countries should be allowed to move between those countries so that parents and children can stay in contact or get back together as a family. 6. Governments should take steps to stop children being taken out of their own country illegally. This article is particularly concerned with parental abductions. The Convention's optional protocol on the sale of children, child prostitution, and child pornography has a provision that concerns abduction for financial gain. 7. When adults are making decisions that affect children, children have the right to say what they think should happen and have their opinion taken into account. 8. Children have the right to get and share information as long as the information is not damaging to them or others. In exercising the right to freedom of expression, children have the responsibility to also respect the rights, freedoms, and reputations of others. The freedom of expression includes the right to share information in any way they choose, including by talking, drawing, or writing. Children have the right to think and believe that they want and to practice their religion as long as they are not stopping other people from enjoying their rights. Children have the right to meet together and to join groups and organizations as long as it does not stop other people from enjoying their rights. In exercising their rights, children have the responsibility to respect the rights, freedoms, and reputations of others. 11. Children have a right to privacy. The law should protect them from attacks against their way of life, their good name, their families, and their homes. 12. Children have the right to get information that is important to their health and well-being. Governments should encourage mass media, radio, TV, and internet content sources to provide information that children can understand and to not promote materials that could harm children. Mass media should particularly be encouraged to supply information in language that minority and children understand. children should also have access to children's book. Both parents share responsibility for bringing up their children and should always consider what is best for each child. Governments must respect the responsibility of parents for providing appropriate guidance to their children. The convention does not take responsibility for children away from their parents and give more authority to governments. It places a responsibility on governments to provide support services to parents, especially if both parents work outside home. 14. Children have the right to be protected from being hurt and mistreated physically or mentally. Government should ensure that children are properly cared for and protect them from violence, abuse, and neglect by their parents. 15. Children who cannot be looked after by their own family have a right to special care and must be looked after properly by people who respect their ethnic group, religion, culture, and language. 16. Children have the right to care and protection. If they are adopted or in foster care, the first concern must be what is best for them. The same rules should apply whether they are adopted in the country where they were born or if they are taken to live in another country. 17. Children have the right to special protection and help if they are refugees, if they have been forced to leave their home and live in another country, as well as all the rights in this convention. 18. Children who have any kind of disability have the right to special care and support, as well as all the rights in the convention, so that they can live full and independent lives. 19. Children have the right to good quality health care, the best health care possible, to safe drinking water, nutritious food, a clean and safe environment, and information to help them stay healthy. Rich countries should help poorer countries achieve this. Children who are looked after by their local authorities rather than parents have the right to have these living arrangements looked at regularly to see if they are the most appropriate. Their care and treatment should always be based on the best interest of the child. 21. Children, either through their guardians or directly, have the right to help from the government if they are poor or in need. 22. Children have the right to a standard of living that is good enough to meet their physical and mental needs. Government should help families and guardians who cannot afford to provide this, particularly regard to food, clothing, and housing. 23. All children have the right to a primary education, which should be free. Wealthy countries should help poorer countries achieve this right. Discipline in schools should respect children's dignity. For children to benefit from education, schools must be run in an orderly way, without the use of violence. Any form of social discipline should take into account the child's human dignity. Therefore, governments must ensure that school administrators review their discipline policies and eliminate any discipline practices involving physical or mental violence, abuse, or neglect. The convention places a high value on education. Young people should be encouraged to reach the highest level of education of which they are capable. 24. Children's education should develop each child's personality, talents, and abilities to the fullest. Minority or indigenous children have the right to learn about the practice, their own culture, language, and religion. The right to practice one's own culture, language, and religion applies to everyone. The convention here highlights the rights in instances where the practices are not shared by the majority of people in the country. 26. Children have the right to relax and play and to join in a wide range of cultural, artistic, and other recreational activities. 27. The government should protect children from work that is dangerous or might harm their health or their education. 28. Governments should use all means possible to protect children from the use of harmful drugs and from being used in the drug trade. 29. Governments should protect children from all forms of sexual exploitation and abuse. The provision in the convention is augmented by the optional protocol on the sale of children, child prostitution, and child pornography. 30. The government should take all measures possible to make sure that children are not abducted, sold, or trafficked. 31. Children should be protected from any activity that takes advantage of them or could harm their welfare and development. 32. No one is allowed to punish children in a cruel or harmful way. Children who break the law should not be treated cruelly. They should not be put in a prison with adults, should be able to keep in contact with their families, and should not be sentenced to death or life imprisonment without possibility of release. 33. Governments must do everything they can to protect and care for children affected by war. Children who have been neglected, abused, or exploited should receive special help to physically and psychologically recover and reintegrate into society. Particular attention should be paid to restoring the health, self-respect, and dignity of the child. 35. Children who are accused of breaking the law have the right to legal help and fair treatment in a justice system that respects their rights. Governments are required to set a minimum age below which children cannot be held criminally responsible and to provide minimum guarantees for the fairness and quick resolution of judicial or alternative proceedings. 36. If the laws of a country provide better protection of children's rights than the article in the convention, those laws should apply. 37. Government should make the convention known to adults and children. Adults should help children learn about their rights too. Establishes 18 as the minimum age for compulsory recruitment and requires states to do everything they can to prevent individuals under the age of 18 from taking a direct part in hostilities. The optional protocol on the sale of children, child prostitution, and child pornography draws special attention to the criminalization of these serious violations of children's rights and emphasizes the importance of fostering increased public awareness and international cooperation in efforts to combat them. 6. UN Convention on the Rights of Children, India. UNCRC, India. India ratified UNCRC on 11th December 1992, agreeing in principles all articles except with certain reservations on issues relating to child labor. In India, there is law that children under the age of 18 should not work, but there is no outright ban on child labor, and the practice is generally permitted in most industries except those deemed hazardous. Although a law in October 2006 banned child labor in hotels, restaurants, and as a domestic servants, there continues to be high demand for children as hired help in the home. A few of the organizations who worked with children's rights in India are Plan India, CRY, that is Child Rights and You, Save the Children, Bal Vikas Dhara, New Delhi, Bachpan Bachao Andolan, and CORD Hyderabad. Now, teacher education on human rights. Modernization may not be civilization. It is observed that with the modernization, there is degeneration of values in all spheres. The degradation of values has gone to the extent that human beings are treated more as objects than living beings, with all rights to live with dignity. On one side, there is a movement of liberation and globalization. On the other side, there are threats of rigidity and fragmentation. On one side, there are marches for peace, whereas on the other side, there is emerging chaos. The basic question is that of realization of peace and harmony. To achieve peace and harmony in all walks of life, it is necessary that education integrates values and rights. These need to be integrated and conceptualized with their regular subjects like languages, science, math, social sciences, etc. So the teacher's role becomes more crucial. If teachers educate properly, then children are able to differentiate between right and wrong, what to do, what not to do, and they will protect their own rights. At the same time, they will develop respect for others' rights. There is a need to enhance sensitivity to the basic values and rights. Education as a potent agent can help enhancement of sensitivity to the basic values and rights. National Human Rights Commission, NHRC, discussed human rights education for university students on 22nd Feb 2006 at New Delhi. The experts voiced their concern on the existing gap between what is being done in the teaching profession and what is actually happening on the ground. Preparation of multimedia training manuals or modules for teachers on how to teach the issue of human rights was suggested. Today, violation of human rights are observed in day-to-day life, so it is necessary to make the people aware of human rights. However, creating awareness about human rights among students would have a far-reaching impact because they are the backbones of our future society. Tomorrow, they would have to manage all walks of life in our society. If they understand the concept of human rights, they will successfully implement it in their future life. Teachers are the most powerful functionaries for social reformation and more so for students. Students make teachers their patterns to live and to die. Unless the sensitivities of the teachers to the human rights are developed, the respect for human rights is rather difficult to be realized. The sensitivity of the teachers to the human rights can definitely facilitate the realization of human rights in the present and the progressive generation thereof. Any educational effort loses its vitality if it does not give adequate attention and importance to the teacher, one of the most important pillars of education. Teachers have always been employed for building the characters of peoples. Teachers have an indispensable role in extension and social service. The Kothari Commission, way back in 1966, has said that no nation can rise above the level of its teachers. A teacher has to act as a catalyst agent so that the change does not spill over. A teacher has to perform two roles simultaneously: a conserver in order to conserve and preserve the continuity of traditions, and secondly, a crusader for change towards desirable objectives, national and global. The teachers, therefore, should be sensitized towards the constitutional goals of justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity, assuring dignity of an individual and integration of the nation. Teachers are the resources to impart knowledge of human rights in society. The present scenario made it imperative to intervene in this area. There is a need to educate teachers on human rights through technology-enabled programs. Teacher education must not lose sight of the basic thrust so as to empower teacher to inculcate the same among the pupils. Another important point is that the education of teachers is not an end in itself, but it is targeted for schools. Any change in school education necessitates corresponding changes in teacher education. Today, school education envisages developing a child respect for human rights as well as duties, NCF 2000. Hence, there is an urgent need to include human rights in the teacher education curriculum, as a trained teacher could share and shoulder the responsibility of teaching of human rights in the right way. We human beings in all walks of life, irrespective of roles and positions, need to be sensitive to human rights. these rights need to be respected at any cost to make the society meaningfully livable. Thank you.